Morning and welcome to worship this morning. Now, I think everyone watched the weather forecast and thought they'd be snowed in this morning. I know, if you're feeling as though getting up and being out and active is hard, Denise had to head up to Oatlands this morning to lead worship. So she was watching the weather forecast yesterday going, will it be safe to go or not? It's good to be with you, and it's wonderful to see a nice, bright, sunny day. And for those joining us at home for worship, good to have you with us also. Our call to worship has the call to worship, the acknowledgement of country, and the candle lighting all in the same block. And when it comes to that time, Mary, are you happy to light the Christ candle for us? Seeing tomorrow's the anniversary of the renewal of your wedding vows. There you go. I'll get you two matches ready. That's your quota. Oh yeah, you can do that. It'll be in the middle there, sir. Our land is alive with the glory of God. Desert sands hum and gum trees dance. Brown grasses sing and mountains breathe their stillness. All created things add their rhythms of delight, and even stones wrap out their praise. Let our voices mingle with those of the earth. May our hearts join the beat of her joy, for our triune God is with us. The source of all being surrounds and holds us. Christ Jesus walks beside and before us. The Spirit moves within and between us. Blessed be God, our wonder and delight. We acknowledge that through this land, God nurtured and sustained the first peoples of this country, the Aboriginal and Islander peoples. We honour them for their custodianship of the land on which we gather today. We acknowledge that the first peoples had already encountered the Creator God before the arrival of the colonisers. The Spirit was already in the land, revealing God to the people through law, custom and ceremony. We acknowledge that that same love and grace that was finally and fully revealed in Christ had sustained the first peoples and given them particular insights into God's ways. And so we rejoice in the reconciling purpose of God found in the good news about Jesus Christ, the light of the world. The light has come into the world, and the darkness cannot consume it. Amen. And so we join together in singing praise to God, praise to the Almighty. Stand and sing loud.
Thank you. Thanks, Tim. Good to hear the pipe organ again. It's been a while since we've heard it, and it sounds quite in tune for a cooler morning. It's done. Let us pray. Loving Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, Creator, Redeemer, and Sustainer of it all, it is a privilege to gather as your people, to see your face in the face of all who gather here, online, in other buildings, or wherever they come together to praise your name. May the praises of your people be raised. May our joy of gathering with others who also know you as Lord of their lives bring forth a collective sense of awe, of wonder, of amazement at your greatness. We offer our praise for who you are, not what you do or what you created or how you've shown your love for us, but who you are, Lord. Let us rest in a moment's silence, a time to feel and sense your presence, to speak from our hearts and minds words of praise and adoration for who you are. Our loving God calls us to worship, and we come, some with laughter and songs of joy, some from a sense of obligation or habit, some with hearts heavy with grief. God calls us to worship, and we come, some with distraction or even exhaustion, some with eagerness and enthusiasm, some with stress, loneliness, or depression. As God's dearly loved children, we bring all our joy and pain, hurt and hope into the place where we worship this day. And may God's Spirit give us grace, love and hope. And may God's Spirit be upon us, taking whatever we offer in worship and making it acceptable and worthy worship of you. This we pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Our God isn't just a God who's in this building for a couple of hours on a Sunday morning, but a God who's alive in all our living. And so as we come to our connecting community notices, we see some of the life and heartbeat of our community. Does anyone have a God experience or a struggle or a joy that they want to share with the community this morning? Anything that's happened in your life that's been exciting or otherwise? Oh, we've got two hands. Ali, do you want to run with the microphone this morning? That'll warm you up. So who had their hands up? Heather did and Bobby did, I think. So Heather's probably closest in here. Thanks, Ali.
Well, in 2020, Ram and I had our 50th wedding anniversary, and it was a year of COVID. Then last year we couldn't do anything. This year we couldn't do anything. So finally on Thursday night we were able to go out to dinner with our son and his children and wife, and we had a lovely dinner, and it was everything rolled up into one, really, because we've had illness and things happening. Grandson falling off one of those stupid scooters. And so it went on. And finally, I said to my son, it's like a prep teacher or an inexperienced prep teacher rounding up the kids for phys ed and getting them out the door. But we did it.
Excellent. Ah, that sounds great that you were able to have that time of celebration together as a family.
Well, I've got friends from Queensland, and I normally look after their farm and their dog and their chooks when they go away overseas, and they haven't been away. So they've come to visit me, which is great, and they've motivated me to do lots of essential work at my house that's been delayed for much time.
Nothing like visitors coming to cause a flurry of housework and other bits to be attended to.
Last Friday, I got together with the girls that I used to sow with on a weekly basis some years ago, and then it dropped to fortnightly when one of our number passed away. And we got together and talked sowing around a nice log fire up in New Norfolk. But the fires were going, all was well. But it was just lovely, and I stopped several times to think the hubbub of voices and, you know, the joy of the company of people that you know and like, who like what you like and all of that. And I thought, yeah, this is good.
Yeah, yeah. Absolutely. Absolutely. And Sue's got her hand up. Thanks, Sue.
We celebrated, Des and I. The pipes are up, the downwater's contained. Telstra next to us have been pussyfooting around replacing all the guttering and the downpipes for 10 years, and it's finally happened. The poor men were fixing it up over that cold spell, and we don't have any rivulets running through the backyard now.
Yay.
So, yay!
I could say something about streaming services, but I won't. Anyone else? Ali, you got anything to share? What did youth group do on Friday night?
We made Anzac biscuits.
So there's a whole box of Anzac biscuits in the kitchen for whoever's on the morning tea roster next. All made by the youth group. Thanks, Mary.
A friend of ours joined us for worship last week, and she said how much she really, really enjoyed it, and she loved being... She felt really welcome. And just wanted to pass on her thanks.
Excellent. Thanks for having me. And Bill, who was a lady over here, was enjoying the space also, and is looking to bring her family along too. So that's good. So the rosters are online. One day I'll do a little video thing of how to actually click on it and fill it in that might assist some people, but I don't stress. If there's people on there, there is, and if there isn't, there isn't. The Bible will still be read, we'll still worship, and things will still happen. So, but feel free to be part of that too. Park redevelopment, before the end of the month, you'll probably find that the park is fenced off. So if you want to go and get photos of it or enjoy the park in the way that it is, that you've probably remembered it for the past 30 years or more, now's your last opportunities in the coming weeks to do that. Trees will go, everything will go, so that redevelopment will start. They'll start fencing it off hopefully before the end of this month. And work will start the beginning of July on that. So we're really fortunate to have that work going. Crafty Friends is this week at 10 a.m. And anyone who has never thought of coming along to bring your knitting and do the sort of stuff that Lorraine was talking about, sitting around talking and just enjoying some craft time with others, you're more than welcome, 10 o'clock on Wednesday. Friends of Thomas is this week also at 7:30. David?
I want to say something now.
Yeah, go for it, yeah.
You might have noticed in Connecting Community that for Friends of Thomas this week, we're going to talk about a video, which is a discussion or debate between two eminent scientists, the well-known Richard Dawkins, who's a well-known atheist, and Francis Collins, who's a Christian scientist, and he was the man involved in the mapping of the human genome. Mm-hmm. The two of them are discussing together and putting forth their different points of view, and then we're going to discuss what they say. So if you'd like to come to our place on Wednesday night, you're very welcome. If you would like to look at the video beforehand over these next couple of cold days, then we can give you the link to that. The other things, while I'm here, just to mention about the forum next Sunday, Housing Crisis for Older Women. When I last looked, it looked as if there'd be about 30 of us total here. I think by that stage, 21 people had registered online, and it's still very much open for that. And we'll organise the catering about midweek, according to the numbers that they look to be by then. But... that's next Sunday. Thank you.
And that's probably a good space to invite friends and people you know in other churches and spaces that might have an interest in that subject also, yeah. Youth groups on Friday night again. The following Friday night, just to jump down a bit, there's karaoke night at Kingston to help raise funds for the accommodation that they have on site at Kingston Uniting Church. So our youth group will be going down there for a karaoke night. Anyone else who likes to do karaoke or is interested in going down to help fundraise for that, you're more than welcome. So they've got a good list of bits and pieces there for that. Quiz night for BCC Africa. I'm guessing we must be pretty close to all those tables being sold now. Check with Chris if you're still interested and you haven't. I'm looking at taking some time off over the school holidays as I start eating into last year's holidays, which I haven't touched yet. So if there's a team or teams or people interested in helping lead on the 17th and 24th of July, happy to resource, equip, support you and help you to do that. David's looking after connecting community for the moment. Until the end of August? Somewhere there, so yep. So send your notices through there or yep, that'd be helpful. Anything else that people need to be mindful of? Heather. Oh, and church council's meeting on that third... Did I put it on there? Can't see. 20th of that Monday night of June.
I just noticed this morning... It may have been there last week. There's a thank you for the Christmas bowl. Oh, okay, sorry.
There's a thank you letter and a certificate for the Christmas bowl. I'll just read parts of it. Thank you, dear friends at Hobart North Uniting. Thank you so much for joining again with churches across Australia and sharing God's love through last year's Christmas bowl. And then they go on to talk about the outbreak of war in Ukraine. And it said, yet despite all the difficulties and heartbreak we're living through, thousands of Australian Christians united in taking practical action in sharing Christmas with refugees in Ethiopia and with communities around the world who have been forced from their homes by conflict and disaster. Thanks to the generosity of our Australian churches, our local partner in Ethiopia, the Ethiopian Orthodox Church Development and Interchurch Aid Commission, can now provide more refugees with food, shelter, and life-saving support. Now, while this certificate only lists $260, I know that most people were like myself and made their donations online, and that won't necessarily be linked to our church contribution. And I do know that many more dollars were donated through here to the Christmas Bowl. Thank you.
Yes, there's usually many thousands more that go into those spaces from there. And there is also a link I think I put in the notices to the... not the Lent event, the 7 days of solidarity. So if you wish to click that link and just spend a couple of minutes offering some feedback into that space, when we had those daily emails and looked at those places across the globe, I personally find that a more helpful approach than the previous Lent event approach to that time of year and looking at that. So so feel free to respond into that space. Anything else? Sharing community. Whatever. What does whatever mean? Whatever does whatever mean? Yeah.
You can't be bothered thinking about it, so
whatever, whatever. Have you ever experienced the whatever attitude from someone? You know, when you're at the checkout and someone decides that all your groceries, whether they're breakables or not, all go in piled in on top of each other, or tomatoes at the bottom with the heavy tins of soup on top and all those sorts of things. Somewhere in life we encounter the whatever attitude frequently. Pete Dennehy is a magic violinist and guitar player and country music, did a video clip a few years ago that was a father and son, or appeared to be that way, each end of the kitchen table with a whole heap of things around them and these questions being fired, and the son's sort of, grunt, grunt, groan, groan. So we haven't got a license to that, but we have got a license to this version of it from Pete Dennehy. So let's have a look. Just dragging some clips around.
How have you been? How's your dog? How's college going? Well, lucky Dory?
Yeah.
You going out tonight?
Yeah.
You going to see your friends?
Yeah.
You going to have a good catch-up?
Yeah.
Well, it should be great.
Yeah.
Where'd you go? Who'd you see?
No one.
What'd you do?
Nothing.
Did you have a good time?
Yep.
What's on tonight?
Nothing.
You're not seeing your mates?
No.
You're just staying at home?
Yep.
What'll you do?
Nothing. Yep, nothing, nothing, sort of, don't I, no, we good, yep, no, don't I, no one, sort of, don't I, nothing.
You feeling all right?
Yep.
How's your ankle?
Good.
When's your exam? Have you done much study?
No.
What's on tomorrow?
Don't know.
You playing cricket?
Don't know.
Enjoying cricket?
Sort of.
Sort of, eh?
Yep. No, sort of, don't know. No, we're good. Yep, no, don't know. No, I'm sort of, don't know.
How's your girlfriend?
Good.
Is she away this week?
Yep.
Oh, you must be missing her.
Yep.
Have you rung her yet?
No.
Well, I'll catch you later.
Yep.
Don't get too stressed.
No.
What's on tomorrow?
What?
What's on tomorrow?
No. Nothing, sort of, don't I? No, one sort of, don't I? Nothing altogether now, nothing, sort of, don't I? Good. No, sort of, don't I? Nothing. Yeah, whatever.
See you later, folks! How have you been?
Good.
How's your dog?
Good.
How's college going?
Good.
Well, lucky Dory?
Yep.
You going out tonight?
So if you ever get a chance to see Pete Dennehy, if he's performing down here, he's a brilliant performer and, just amazing. What could a script like that have to do with Paul, who's in prison, and writing to the church at Philippi? You don't have to answer that. In the scripture reading coming up, Paul uses the word whatever many times. So listen for it when it comes up. But before we get to there, after the scripture reading, we will, in prayer of confession, there's a song, Jehovah Jireh, My Provider. Jehovah Jireh is a term used in the scriptures in Genesis 22 or around there. Abraham and Sarah were promised that they'd have a child, and they don't. And so Abraham and Hagar take it into their hands, and with Sarah's blessing or push or whatever, Ishmael's born. And then a dozen years later or so, along comes a son that was promised. And there's that sense that comes after that that Abraham's led out to sacrifice Isaac. And I think as we talked in September, October last year when we were looking at that passage, that if we follow the Christian heritage line, it's Isaac that's the one that's going to be given as a sacrifice. But if we follow the Islamic tradition, it's actually Ishmael that's the one who is given there. But the place is, name gets called Jehovah Jireh, Jehovah Yahweh, God, Jireh provides. And that sense that God provides our needs regardless of what's going on, that sense that God steps in and our needs are taken care of. And so that place is named Jehovah Jireh. And in this passage of Paul in the last part of Philippians, the material that we had didn't actually continue on to conclude chapter 4 of Philippians. It's not used in the narrative lectionary. It's not used in the Revised Common Lectionary. So you've probably never heard a sermon on this this passage before. But as I looked at it, I'm going, I want to use that and I want to finish that book that way. There's a deep sense in Paul of knowing both God's providence and Paul's own steadfast reliance on God as those two things to come together that have held Paul. And Paul wants this everlasting testimony to who God is in that. And that despite the gifts that we'll hear about and the support from the church at Philippi, he doesn't want to downplay these, but Paul wants people to know, however grateful he is, that God's grace would have still been sufficient to get him through, as he's been through good and bad times. It's God that's held him in that. And so Kirsten's going to bring us our scripture reading from Philippians chapter 4. Thanks, Kirsten.
Reading from Philippians chapter 4, verses 8 to 23. Finally, beloved, whatever is true, whatever is honourable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is pleasing, whatever is commendable, if there is any excellence and if there is anything worthy of praise, think about these things. Think about these things. Keep on doing the things that you have learned and received and heard and seen in me, and the God of peace will be with you. I rejoice in the Lord greatly that now at last you have revived your concern for me. Indeed, you were concerned for me, but had no opportunity to show it. Not that I'm referring to being in need, for I have learned to be content with whatever I have. I know what it is to have little, and I know what it is to have plenty. In any and all circumstances, I have learned the secret of being well fed and of going hungry, of having plenty and of being in need. I can do all things through him who strengthens me. In any case, it was kind of you to share my distress. If you Philippians indeed know that in the early days of the gospel, when I left Macedonia, no church shared with me in the matter of giving and receiving except you alone. For even when I was in Thessalonica, you sent me help for my needs more than once. Not that I seek the gift, but I seek the profit that accumulates to your account. I have been paid in full and have more than enough. I am fully satisfied now that I have received from Epaphroditus the gifts you sent, a fragrant offering, a sacrifice acceptable and pleasing to God. And my God will fully satisfy every need of yours according to his riches in glory in Christ Jesus. To our God and Father be glory forever and ever. Amen. Greet every saint in Christ Jesus. The friends who are with me greet you. All the saints greet you, especially those of the Emperor's household. The grace of the Lord Jesus Christ be with your spirit. For these words of Scripture and Jesus the living word.
Together with the last chapter of Philippians, and you'll remember it as the whatever passage. Let us pray. Lord, we confess that like the Apostle Paul, we desire for Christ to be the focus of our life. There are times when, despite our freedom and all that we have, our witness is a mere fraction of Paul's witness. Paul, who was in prison, yet we who are free. Paul leaned into the power of the risen Lord in all of his living and regardless of his circumstances. Prison was an opportunity to witness to those who shared the cell and the guards beyond. It was an opportunity to write letters of encouragement and support to the churches that need this, and letters that reminded others of their commitment to being followers of the way to those who needed that. As we sit here this morning, Lord, we take a few moments to reflect on whether we need letters of encouragement and support, or whether we need letters to remind us of what our responses should be as followers of the way. You've called us to be the church, to continue the mission of Christ to the lonely and confused world. Yet we acknowledge we are more apathetic than active. We're more isolated than involved, more callous than compassionate at times, more obstinate than obedient, and more legalistic than loving. Lord, as we lean into the reality of how we live out our privileged lives, it's hard to see the leading of Paul, to be content with whatever we have, whether much or whether little. Living Christ, for us to truly confess you as Lord of our lives, may we be seen to testify to your greatness regardless of our circumstances. Gracious Lord, may your Spirit be upon us and speak into our hearts and minds and shine forth into the lives of others. Have mercy upon us and forgive our turning our backs on you and your peoples. Remove the obstacles preventing us from being a representative to a broken world. Awaken our hearts to the promised gift of your indwelling Spirit that we heard about last week. And may your grace always be sufficient for all our needs. This we pray in Jesus' powerful name. Amen. The God who challenges us is also the God who encourages us. The God who confronts us is also the God who accepts us. Be assured that God is with us even now, accepting, guiding and forgiving. Thanks be to God. So if anyone remembers that chorus from the 80s, I hope it's an earworm in your head for the rest of the week as you remember God's provision and being there for us. So this whatever and this implicit trust in who God is, Paul hangs on to that. And I have no doubt his faith would have wavered at times, but there's something strong and true in what he's been through and what gets him to the point of where he is, this letter that's written in prison. So we're holding two ideas in our head now. We've got this whatever attitude, and we've got this God will provide, Jehovah Jireh, God my provider. So we've got these two things together. We've got Paul in prison, and Paul knew what it was to be both slave and to be free. He knew what it was to be in relationship with God and the cost of not being in that relationship. We heard the whatever attitude in Pete Dennehy's song. Let's actually listen for, in this next video clip, the sense of whatever. That's a very different approach to whatever. I've just got a few moments as the clip comes across.
We can't just give up and wait for war. We need to get back to work bringing slaves to freedom. By train or carriage, horseback, on foot if necessary.
Harriet, the journey from Maryland to Canada is 600 miles from the Canadian border. Your longest trip was 100. Now, that would take months, not weeks. You can't...
I ain't giving up rescuing slaves because it's far. Many of you don't know slavery firsthand. You were born free. You've been free so long, you forget what it's like. You've gotten comfortable and important. You got beautiful homes, beautiful wives. But I remember, children beat for not working, for they understand what work is. Girls raped for their first blood. Brothers whipped to their back and ripping. Sisters sold from their babies. Try not to think of what they went through. Those still enslaved are going through right now. But I've heard their groans and their sighs. I've seen their tears, and I would give every last drop of blood in my veins to free them. So I ain't giving up. I'm gonna do what I gotta do. Go wherever I gotta go. However I gotta do it. To free as many slaves as possible. To this beast, this monster called slavery is slain dead.
Amen.
It is like, and I give every last drop of blood in my veins to free them. So I ain't giving up. I'll do whatever I got to do. Go wherever I got to go, however I got to do it, to free my many as many slaves as possible till the beast, this monster called slavery, is slain to death. To do whatever it takes. A very different understanding of whatever to the song we had before. Paul starts this passage singling out two women within the church at Philippi who've been quarreling and taking the attention away from the ministry and creating disunity, and a church that's at a fragile point, or at any point really, doesn't need to be fractured by broken relationships. It makes it harder for the community. It makes it more dangerous for the community. It is only the privileged that can afford to argue. How does that rest with you? It's only the privileged that can afford to argue. Those who are without have to work together and put everything that they have together to survive. Otherwise, none of them survive. The Christian church here at this point is fragile. This is before the Gospels have been written. But Paul names this sense of joy in these two women coming together and agreeing. For Paul, over and over again, what is it that I've said is important for Paul? Christ, not circumstance. Christ, not circumstance. Having dealt with this, he turns to, as some of the scriptures say, the brethren, which isn't referring to brothers, but in the way it's used and in the language there, it means those others left over. So he's addressed the critical concerns, but to everyone else and everything else that's left over, whatever's true, whatever is honourable, whatever is just, whatever is pure, whatever is pleasing, whatever is commendable, these things hold the community together and help them to be the people of God as they need to be. They're those things that have to be held on to, whatever. They have to be held on to. And God's peace will be with you. And you'll be the community that you need to be. A community that builds its life around these ways will be strong. We'll have less bickering and arguing. And will better confess and profess Christ as Lord through their actions. verse 10, he addresses that gift from the church at Philippi. Have you ever had a time in your life when you've worked hard for something and you think that you're pretty proud of what you've done, and then someone just steps in to help or whatever, and suddenly it's not all your own, and you feel something's taken away, but you don't want to push away their gift. You appreciate it and the way it was given, but you just feel as though, hey, I could have actually done this on my own or together with God. I remember when I was 18 and had my first motorbike, I'd saved up to pay the registration, etc., and I went to pay the registration bill and I couldn't find it, and I went into this mad panic because I couldn't find my registration bill, and I'm good at losing bits of paper. And I said to Dad, I can't find this. He said, it's okay, I've already taken care of it, I've paid it. And I'm going, and there's that sense that, fantastic, thank you for that, but I was also trying to be independent and I'd saved up and this was mine. I paid for the motorbike, I wanted to pay for the rego and that sense of those things. And maybe Paul's not on about motorbikes here, but there's that sense of thanks, I appreciate it, but I've learned to survive without that kind of support. And this is where Paul's a little caught. He's thankful, but it's like it's taken the shine off, but he still wants to let them know that he appreciates their gifts and their support. But almost a sense of it could have given more glory to God if it was just reliance on God alone. I rejoice greatly. I learned to be content in whatever. That word again. I learned to be content in whatever. I know what it is to have little and I know what it is to have plenty. Learn the secret of being well fed and going hungry, of having plenty and being in need. I can do all things through him who strengthens me. In any case, it was kind of you to share my distress. And I wonder for Paul if it's that sense of not necessarily that monetary gifts that had been given when he was going through lots of his ministry and how the church at Philippi continued to support him. Whether it was the monetary gifts or whether he knew that it was their prayers, their support, their thinking of him and their being on the journey with him that was more important than the money that came his ways. You Philippians indeed know that in the early days when I left Macedonia, no church shared with me in the matter of giving and receiving except you alone. Not that I seek the gift, but I seek the profit that accumulates to your account. What's the profit that accumulates to their account in being faithful in supporting Paul in his mission and his ministry? It's that they grow also in the faith. It's that they reach out to others and they learn to give. And that key verse, chapter 4, verse 19, and my God will satisfy every need of you according to his riches in glory in Christ. It's a bit like Beethoven's Fifth Symphony. Paul has about four or five endings to this, and each time you think it's ended, it's then another group of people thanked, and it goes on and on. And as we sang before, Jehovah Jireh, my provider, his grace is sufficient for me. My God will supply all my needs according to his riches in glory. Not necessarily the needs we think need providing, but that sense of presence, of being there, of providing. And his final greeting. Greet every saint in Christ Jesus. The friends who are with me greet you. I guess as I look at a passage like this, the question that comes to me is, what does it mean to have that sort of strength of faith? And what does it mean to support others in that space? Is Paul a pastor, a prophet, an evangelist, a teacher, a shepherd? What is Paul's ministry in this place? Maybe it's a bit of everything. And I think it takes us to our discussion question. What are the whatevers that we should flip in our life? That we have those times and those places where we go, yeah, whatever. It's not important, doesn't matter. But some of those are worthy of being flipped. And some of those things that we invest in, whatever the case, we're still going to do that, need to be flipped to a bit of a whatever. And so, which one are we going to take? Harriet, from that incredible clip about slavery and doing whatever, or the Pete Dennehy, whatever, it doesn't matter.
The word awe should be up there. What takes or might exhibit the greatest trust? And there's something on the flip side of those whatevers. I see no need to invest or assist because whatever, God's there, so I don't have to stress about it. Or the whatever, I will stress about it and I'll do everything I can because it's important to do that in Christ. Are they both valid and trust responses? Different sides of the same coin. Yeah, Betty.
This is from the testimony of friends of ours who were missionaries in Lebanon at the time of the Civil War. They had three little children, and they were in. They found themselves, of course, in the Christian being Beirut. They were in the Christian part of the city, and the war was getting worse. And they were given instructions came through from the missionary society saying, "You leave." And so the city was in absolute chaos. They were coming through the city in a taxi, and they had to get through the enemy section of the city to get to the airport. The airport was being bombarded at that stage. They got to the airport, and suddenly it became they'd been given money by the local church, got through safely to the airport, and discovered that they didn't have enough money to book on the last flight that was coming through from Cairo. And it was decided that the wife and children would go and the husband would stay behind. It was a very dangerous thing to do, but that's what was happening. And so he was on the point of saying goodbye to his family. They would be getting on the plane to, if the plane left, to safety in Cairo, and suddenly, as they were heading out to the gate to go through, somebody, a gentleman in the midst of the chaos, came running into the terminal holding up something and saying, "A passport, a passport. I found a passport. Who does this belong to? It must belong to a Westerner here." And as they had been, he hadn't realised at this stage, but as they were coming through in the taxi, somehow he'd lost his passport. The father had lost his passport. And so he couldn't, even if there'd been money, he couldn't leave because he'd lost his passport. And this man from the opposite side of the Civil War had brought it in so that a Westerner on the other side of the fight could leave the country, but he had no money. So family's still moving, and an Egyptian came up to the family and said, "I've just flown in from Cairo on the plane that they were going out on. I'm an Egyptian businessman, and I'm a Christian, and before I left Cairo to come here, the church gave him a certain amount of money and said, somebody in Lebanon, some Christians in Lebanon, will need that money. It's our gift from our church to whoever you give it to." That's trust, to give it to him, to give to somebody. So he handed over the money to the father. It was enough to get him out of the country.
Wow. That's incredible.
I'm currently reading Richard Feidler's book about Istanbul, the city of Istanbul, which for a long time was the capital of the Eastern Roman Empire. Paul's writing 300 years before that, before it became a Christian empire. And yet in that last little couple of lines of Philippians, when he's bringing greetings from those who are with him, especially those who are in the emperor's household.
Yeah.
And Paul, who had, if you like, said, "Well, whatever it takes, you know, if I need to go to prison, then I will." He'd taken his strong belief in the gospel with him to Rome. He was imprisoned under the emperor's will. And And there were Christians already at that stage in the emperor's household, possibly slaves, but they were there.
Yeah. It's amazing stories, isn't it, of how God works through all of that.
Philippians 4:19 has been a verse through my life, and regardless of Jehovah Jireh, I have a chorus that runs through my life from the 50s, not the 80s, of Philippians 4:19, and it comes whenever I need it, and it's just there that God will supply all my needs.
Yeah.
Needs, not wants. That's needs. Yeah, and it's just lovely today to be reminded of that yet again.
Yeah. Yeah. Hard to believe this passage doesn't occur in any of the lectionary readings. That's bizarre, isn't it? Yeah. Mary.
After I had Miranda, I actually had postnatal depression, and I'm sure there are other people in the room who've experienced that. And I went through, I received very good help. But the interesting thing was a lot of that help I noticed really, so there was cognitive behaviour therapy and stuff like that. And this passage came to me at the time, whatever is, you know, that where you take your mind, you know, that's actually a choice. And I can remember at the time thinking about how this passage aligned so well with what I was being taught. And it was there all the time.
Yeah, yeah, that's good. So as you go through the week, take your whatever attitude with you. See both sides of the whatever. Whatever, what are the things we can let go of? Whatever, not important. And what are the things that whatever it takes, I will follow through with that because it's important. Our daily living, our attitude, all those things are part of our offerings to God. They are before us and they are within us. And hopefully they make an impact in other people's lives also. Let us pray. Loving God, accept all of our living and through your Spirit make it worthy and acceptable. Lord, change our lives to be lives that our offerings make a difference in other people's lives and that we don't just give to ourselves and to the things that make a difference to us, but make a difference where you need that difference in the world. Lord God, we are a Pentecost people, a people who live by and through the power of your Spirit and in the way of Christ. But we live in a world that has many barriers which need breaking down. And so we pray and work towards a world where barriers are broken down and justice for all is reality. We pray for all who are divided and who find it difficult to communicate what their needs are. We pray for all who are silenced. We pray for all who are imprisoned, whether that be in jail, imprisoned in a relationship, in a job, in a financial situation, in a detention centre, in a body or a mind that locks them away. Or imprisoned in a belief that stops them becoming more fully who you created them to be, or means that they feel as though they are locked away from the relationship and the love that you offer. For those who are drawn to Christ, the light of the world, we pray that they will have the courage and determination of Paul to put their light on a lampstand and to tend it, to fill it, and to let its light shine for all. For all who are worn down by the darkness. We pray for those who are imprisoned by poverty, by homelessness, by a life of crime that they can't let go of, by addictions that
never seemed to set them free. By pain, whether it be emotional or whether it be physical. We pray for those who feel as though their life lacks purpose, for those whose life is lived in indifference, and for those who have their whatevers mixed up. As situations move quickly from the front page of our newspapers or slide quickly to the bottom of our newsfeed, our only response can be to cry out for it all to stop. And Lord, we cry out to you, to our neighbours and to ourselves, for so many things that just need to stop. For war, for political unrest, for climate disasters, for massacres, for bomb blasts, for disasters both natural and those inflicted by others. We pray for our church that with all its wealth and resources, its agency and its capacity, that it will seek to do what is right and just, that it and all of us we'll use what we have to support and assist humanity, to believe that there is hope, there is compassion, that decency does exist, and that the life we live testifies to a living God and Lord of our lives, one where the Spirit is moving, calling, empowering, mending and uniting people one to another and with their God. Lord God, blow through the cold and staleness of our lives. Refresh us with love, with purpose and renewed energy to take your life-changing Spirit into the world, restoring your creation to all that you had hoped for the world. May we never tire of your Spirit's breathing through us, filling us with life and power that overflows and transforms our lives and the lives of others in the way of Paul, in the way of Christ, in the way of your love, and for your glory. Amen. We join in the hymn, "May our lives and our prayers be one as our hopes shape the road we walk on." Those roads that we walk on, and I think of where we started with Paul on that road to Damascus. Saul, Saul, to this person who's prepared to go from being free and in charge to being in prison for the sake of Christ, so that Christ's message can be set free to all.
May we carry that in whatever ways we need and take this light of Christ with us. And the blessing of the Father, Son, and Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you forevermore. Amen.